Okay. How do I know if anybody's there?
It's live. I'm just zero. I have an exercise.
I don't see anybody.
Yes, sir.
I don't see anybody.
So you can stand up.
I don't see anybody. Hello, I'm Dr. Vivek Padegal. I am the Director of Pulmonary Services at Fortis Hospital, Bangalore Road, Bangalore. And I'll be talking to you about lung cancer, risks for lung cancer, and how do we detect, how do we treat. We're going to wait for a few minutes to see if more people join. I will be taking questions as well. So if anybody is have any questions, please write it down to the chat box. Thanks. Okay. Lung cancer is a malignancy of the lung. And malignancy is a form of cancer. Now, not all cancers, I'm sorry, not all malignancies are cancers and vice versa. But for the common parlay, lung cancer is cancer of the lung. There are various types of lung cancers. And based on that, various treatments vary. Lung cancer is more common in smokers. It is more common in urban dwellers, particularly where the pollution levels are higher. And it can present after many years after stopping smoking. So the best way to prevent lung cancer is to never smoke. But if you smoke and you stop, it will actually decrease your chances of lung cancer. So number one risk factor for lung cancer is smoking. So if you're a current smoker, I would recommend you to stop. If you've never tried smoking, I would recommend you never try. That's the first thing. Now, certain air pollution factors are really not in our hands, but as advocates, doctors, and people in society should try and advocate for a cleaner atmosphere. There are certain vocations, certain jobs which can increase your risk for cancer, particularly things like coal mining, being exposed to radiation and such. So that is something to be wary about as well. So how does lung cancer present? Typically, in the beginning, there is no symptoms. So as the disease progresses, unfortunately, you get symptoms. So many times, by the time there are symptoms, it's too late. So a bit of suspicion is needed in this situation. But cough is very common. Sometimes you'll get chest pain. Sometimes you'll get shortness of breath. In the cough, sometimes you get blood. These are the more common symptoms of and the presentation of lung cancer. So usually what we start with is a chest x-ray, and the chest x-ray may show a mass, some abnormality, some enlarged lymph nodes. Then we proceed to look at a CT scan. A CT scan will give us more option, more information. And based on that, there are several ways of biopsying the lung. It can be done outside under CT guidance or ultrasound guidance, or it can be done internally by means of a bronchoscopy. Bronchoscope is an endoscope of the lung where you go in with a little camera and you can take biopsies from the inside of the lung. There are various types of bronchoscopies that we can do. One is under direct visualization, the other one is under ultrasound visualization, something called EBUS, which we can biopsy as well. So there are various ways of doing it. Once we get a tissue, we process the tissue for pathology and figure out what is the type. There are broadly three categories: squamous, adenocarcinoma, and small cell. And it's important to know what it is because the treatment changes based on it. Now, if the cancer is localized to one area, many times we can take surgery and take out that area. Sometimes you need a combination of chemotherapy and surgery, and sometimes surgery is not an option where we give chemotherapy. Now, we also do a lot of molecular analysis now on the biopsies. Even a small biopsy can give us a lot of information, and we can do something called personalized medicine or targeted treatment. Now, the targeted treatment is depending on the types of genes you have or the type of markers we have. So that has increased the range of what is given to these patients. An adenocarcinoma, sometimes we have something called EGFR, which is one of the first targeted treatments in lung cancer, and that can actually be treated by tablets. So there are a wide range of things. So if somebody has a mass on lung, even if they're not in great shape, I always recommend that a biopsy be done. Number one, to make sure it is cancer. And number two, many cancers can now be treated quite easily by means of tablets. So that's the gist of what we do with lung cancer. How do we diagnose? It's very important to look for comorbidities. That is other things that accompany with the cancer. Many people who smoke also have heart and lung diseases. So these need to be looked at, because if you don't take care of that, cancer care becomes an issue. So we typically do a lung function test to see if the patient has any smoking-related lung problems, something called COPD, and we'll start inhalers. Very often they have concomitant heart issues, which need to be addressed as well. So there's a question here of how to differentiate between lung nodule is inflammatory or not. That is a good question. That is what we do on a daily basis. Something on the CT scan could be cancer, could be something else. There's several ways of looking at it. Up front, depending on the way it looks on CT scan, many times we get a clue of whether it looks like cancer or not. There are some characteristics that both have that an educated doctor can make a good educated guess. Now, another thing we can do is a PET scan. A PET scan is a scan which combines a CT scan with an activity scan called positron emission tomography. So the PET scan will add on to the CT scan and tell us tissue activity. If the tissue is very active, it's most likely cancer. If it's low, it might be a low-grade cancer or something like infection or inflammation. But the gold standard is biopsy. So if you put a biopsy, if we do a biopsy, we have a better idea of what it is. In India, the differentiating factor many, many times is tuberculosis. So a biopsy can help a lot to differentiate between malignancy and TB. And I kind of touched on that when I said most people should get a biopsy to know what is going on. Sometimes the growth of whatever we see on the CT scan is very slow. That could indicate either a slow growing cancer, or it could be an infection, or there are a bunch of other things like sarcoidosis, which can cause that as well. So if there's any doubt, the best way to differentiate is to do a biopsy, if possible. Now, sometimes a bronchoscopic biopsy or a CT-guided biopsy is not possible. Sometimes we have to do a surgical biopsy. And that tends to be a little more involved and more invasive. But in today's technology, for majority of patients, we're able to do it minimally invasive. I have a specific question here about a lung nodule. It is very difficult to say based on a three-line question of what it is. If over a period of 1.5 centimeters, something is getting bigger, even it is 0.3 centimeters, perhaps it needs to be biopsied. But again, it depends on the location. 2.6 centimeters is a fairly large lesion, and perhaps it can be biopsied. At the same time, a 0.3 centimeter over 1.5 years is a little slow growing, but I would recommend it be looked at. If there's any other questions, please free to join the chat. Let me know. I'm here to answer questions. Let me just touch upon something that some people may have read about, something called low-dose CT. In the West, after doing a study in several thousand patients, particularly smokers and former smokers, it is recommended that a periodic low-dose CT scan is done. Low-dose CT scan is not a complete comprehensive scan. It uses less energy, and it looks for abnormalities in people who smoke or used to smoke. The theory is here that if we pick up an early lesion, we can do surgery, we can be more aggressive, and we can save lives. This has not really been validated in India, where we have a background of a lot of other diseases, which can look like lung cancer. But this is a conversation maybe you need to have with your doctor about whether you need it or whether he or she would recommend it, and to see if we can find some early cancers. It's not routinely used. I don't routinely use it because we get a lot of background findings which are very difficult to deal with. Also, early lung cancers are more difficult to biopsy and come to a conclusion. So that is one thing that we need to do more research in India about. So like I was saying, prognosis for lung cancer has really improved compared to 10 years ago, 15 years ago. People are surviving for longer periods of time. They are getting treatment and responding quite dramatically. Early in my career, people would be dead in 6 months after diagnosis. Now we are seeing people live 4, 5, 6 years, perhaps longer with the current medications. So there's definitely hope. It is not a disease of last resort. I mean, you definitely have hope. There are some good treatments available. So I would definitely do a comprehensive evaluation and dig deep, work with your pulmonologist, work with your oncologist, and try and get to the best possible treatment. It is not a hopeless situation anymore. The side effects are minimal. The patients to do a lot better than before. You don't see the massive hair loss or the nausea and vomiting that you used to see in movies 20 years ago. It's actually quite well tolerated. We've got good medications for this. So definitely we need to be hopeful in these situations. Any other questions, please put it on the chat. Okay. One of the things we do typically in these situations is, as a pulmonologist, is we try to optimize symptoms, particularly if somebody is short of breath, they have a fluid accumulation around the lung, we will tap it, we can drain it with tubes. Typically, once it's drained with good chemotherapy, it doesn't resolve. But if it doesn't resolve and the fluid comes back, there are some strategies that we can do to drain the fluid. If a patient has concomitant lung disease, we would start inhalers. They tend to improve things considerably for these patients. We can symptomatically treat cough. We can treat all these symptoms and give the patient a better quality of life. I have a question here about a CT scan to detect cancer. We kind of talked about that. Perhaps you missed the discussion. Yes, CT scan is the way to detect cancer. We sometimes can use something called a low-dose CT scan to do screening, but that's not really in great use in India. But CT scan is probably the first step to detect any sort of cancer. I have a question here about somebody having fever and blood in the sputum. And has maybe a mild infection. Definitely somebody like this, you need to be worried about multiple things. In India, probably the most important thing is tuberculosis in this situation rather than cancer. And then after that, perhaps looking at cancer after the TB. Now, typically what we do is we'll treat for common things like pneumonia, bronchitis, which can lead to blood in the sputum. And then we would get a follow-up x-ray and see. You know, if the x-ray is cleared, patient doesn't have a lot of risk factors like smoking, perhaps that's enough. But many times we'll end up doing a CT scan to make sure there's no underlying issue. Sometimes lung cancer can cause pneumonia by obstructing the airway, and that causes collapse and subsequent infection. So that's something on our radar all the time. We try and look for that as well. So anytime you have blood in the sputum, you need to be careful about it. I have a question here about hyperglycemic medications. I would imagine you're talking about diabetic medications. Now, there is no clear link for diabetic medications and cancer. They're quite life-saving. I wouldn't entertain talk like this because it would deter people from using diabetic medication. They're extremely safe and, like I said, life-saving. Definitely need to take your hyperglycemic medications. Okay, there's a question here, which is quite technical, about what are my modalities of biopsying for lung cancer. The way I approach it is I look at where the lesion is. Now, a CT scan is done like we talked about. Now, depending on the location of the tumor, the approach is decided. And an experienced pulmonologist can help you with that. Now, based on what I do, at least, if the patient's lesion is peripheral towards the edges of the lung and easily approachable, we do a CT-guided biopsy. This is of good value. It gives good specimens. It's relatively cheap. And we're able to get an answer. Now, something more central, where it's not touching the periphery of the lung, doing a biopsy from outside is a little more hazardous, as the needle can collapse the lung. So it's something called a pneumothorax. So in these situations, we try to go internally and do a bronchoscopy. Sometimes bronchoscopy can be done just directly. You go into the airway, you see the tumor in the airway, you just biopsy it. That's the simplest type. But sometimes we need to go outside the airway into the lung. And so we can use an X-ray guidance, something called fluoroscopy, for that, if it's easily accessible. Otherwise, we use something called EBUS. EBUS is simply an ultrasound attached to a bronchoscope. So you have a fiber optic device with a camera, and you have an ultrasound. So we go into the airway, we shine the light, we put the ultrasound, and we can identify things outside the bronchus or the main airways, the trachea and bronchi. And using this guidance, we can do biopsies. This can be done peripherally. It can be done right next to the airways. And we get a fairly good yield with that. There are various technologies to help us to get to the more peripheral areas. But the cost tends to be much higher, considerably higher. So in these settings, what you want to do is you want to look at what is easy for the patient, what is cost effective for the patient, and what is the yield of what we're doing. So when you look at all of these aspects, you come with a plan and you do try to do what gives you the diagnosis the easiest. Many times we pair all of this with a PET scan, which gives us a little more information of where to target the biopsy. So many times now we get a PET scan before a diagnosis of cancer to help guide the biopsy. That tends to improve our yields and become more cost efficient and put the patient through less problems. In terms of liquid biopsy, the science is not really there, especially for upfront biopsy. I think most people prefer at least the first time to do a tissue biopsy. Maybe when there is no other way of getting tissue, we would do a liquid biopsy. But we really tend to try and focus on the tissue. At this point, liquid biopsies are not as reliable as tissue biopsy. Let me talk a little bit about smoking cessation, because it's very important and it is definitely allied to what we're talking about. Smoking is a terrible thing. It causes not only cancer, it can cause emphysema, COPD, causes heart diseases more than anything else. It can cause strokes. It can cause not just lung cancer, it causes about 45 different types of cancers. So it gives gastric cancer, upper airway cancer, sinus cancers, a whole bunch of different cancers. So it's definitely something that we need to stop doing if we can. Now, if you're not able to stop yourself, it is definitely something you need to talk to your doctor about. We have several aids to help us with this, including nicotine patches and some medications. But these need to be done under medical supervision. Also, a few things like yoga, exercise help, and trying to figure out why you're smoking. Many of us have emotional issues, and this cigarette is an emotional crutch. So you need to dig a little deeper. If you've got anxiety, you're not going to stop. If you have depression, you may not stop. So these things need to be looked at. I've had several questions again about symptoms, which I talked up in the beginning. Symptoms can be nonspecific. A cough is usually the commonest one, but you can get chest pain, shortness of breath. Cough with blood in the sputum is definitely a big one. Somebody with non-resolving cough, especially smokers, should be looked at. And it can present any other ways, depending if the cancer is spread outside the lung. You can get joint pains, you can get body pains, you can get headaches, a lot of different things can be there. So it can be pretty nonspecific. So if there's any other questions, please do put them on the chat box. So one thing we do for some patients these days is physiotherapy, believe it or not. A lot of patients come, they've got cancer, they've become deconditioned, they have concomitant lung and heart issues. So a course of physiotherapy helps them regain strength, regain balance. If they're able to do more, feel less short of breath, and we're able to be mobile. So that's one thing. If you do have cancer and it's affecting your life, this is a conversation to have with your doctor, with your pulmonologist, with your oncologist about whether physiotherapy is right for you. Many times patients after chemotherapy can develop infections. That's another place that we get involved with. Infections can be because of immunosuppression. It can be because you had TB all along in your body and you got immunosuppressed and it emerges causing an active TB infection. So that can make it difficult in managing the patient and diagnosing the patients. Again, we use the same tools. We do sputums, we do various types of interventions to try and see if something has changed. With the advent of PET scans and various types of chemotherapies, it definitely has become more complicated looking at the various drug interactions, various types of post-chemotherapy types of problems. But most of these can be handled. Most patients do well. And like I said, it is definitely something that needs to be pursued. Let me see if there's something I'm missing on the questions. I have a question here about breathlessness. Yes, breathlessness can be seen in almost every pulmonary and cardiac disorder. So it is also possible to get both. Wheezing can be seen, and asthma can be seen in COPD. COPD patients can have lung cancer. In fact, they have a higher rate of lung cancer. COPD is cigarette-related lung disease and other environmental exposures. So I think if you're having symptoms, you're having breathlessness, we typically get a lung function test, which will tell us if the patient has asthma or COPD. However, if you're still not getting better, oftentimes up front or later, we get a chest X-ray, and that helps us verify things. Now, if anybody has a history of smoking, we tend to be more aggressive about imaging, getting an earlier CT scan or earlier chest X-ray to see whether we're missing anything else. So definitely that is something that is always on our radar. We always want to see if there's anything else that we haven't. Our rule of thumb in India is anybody with cough more than 3 weeks should get a chest X-ray. That not only helps us look for tuberculosis, it many times helps us pick up tumors and things like that. So definitely that is something on our minds all the time. A lung function test is often done in these patients either before bronchoscopy or after diagnosis, because many people, again, have concomitant lung issues as well as a lung cancer. And many times it's missed because everybody assumes it's the lung cancer causing the issue. So I would recommend, particularly with history of smoking, anybody with lung cancer, get a lung function test to see if symptoms can be improved just with inhalers, as well as giving the treatment for the cancer. So definitely, again, something, if it's not been done, that is a conversation, if anybody's out there who needs it, to have with their doctor. Cancers can present in some weird ways sometimes. They can elevate calcium, which can lead to constipation and can lead to some neurological disorders. It can present by causing neurological disorders, something called a paraneoplastic syndrome. So these things, sometimes like myasthenia can be a paraneoplastic syndrome. You may have heard of myasthenia as Amitabh Bachchan had it. His was a different reason, but that can also present. So like I said, we have to look at a lot of different things and different angles as a doctor, pulling our knowledge, pulling our expertise, and see how we can best help the patients. Let me see if there's anything else. So a lot of questions about symptoms. I think, unfortunately, the most common symptom is no symptom. And many times people come from a health check, they have an X-ray, and they find it. So I touched upon, that was the whole theory about the low-dose CT scan, which I think needs to be validated in India for larger use, but definitely something that can be discussed with your doctor. So cough, feeling of breathlessness, chest pain, coughing up blood, frequent infections, all can be from lung cancer. And then, like I said, you can get some very different symptoms based on where the cancer is spread, unfortunately. People can come in with paralysis if it is in the spine. People can come with seizures if it's in the brain, things like that. But those are unfortunate and usually very spread type of cancers. But even there, there's hope. We've seen pretty good responses to metastatic cancer, that is cancer that is outside the lung. And so definitely anybody in that situation needs to get evaluated and definitely needs to get a trial of treatment in my book today. Can we wrap up? Okay, I'm coming towards the end of the session. If there's any other comments, questions, I'd be free to field it. There's nothing like a dumb question here. If you have anybody has a comment, they don't have a question, that's fine too. If we have somebody here who is a cancer survivor or a cancer patient, I'll be glad to help as I can in this situation. All right. Thank you for your time. It was a pleasure talking to you. Thank you for the good questions.